Hello, I would like to welcome everyone, both here in the funeral home as well as people viewing online. Welcome you to the memorial service honoring Jennifer Johnson. Before we begin, I'd like everyone to take here in the building to take a moment and look at your phone, make sure it's on silent or vibrate. We'd like to avoid any interruptions. Pastor Robin is going to be leading us today. Before that begins, we're going to listen to a song. Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God, Mother of us all, Jesus talked to his disciples soon before his death and wanting to bring them comfort in a situation much like what we face today. He said to them, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to where I am so that you can be with me also. You know the way to the place where I am going." But Thomas, his disciple, said, "No, Lord, we don't know where you are going. How can we know the way?" And Jesus said, "I am the way and the truth and the life." Let us pray. Loving and merciful God, we thank you for the gift of life. From the moment of conception and birth to the moment of our last breath, we live amidst the wonder and beauty of all life and marvel at the gift of what it means to be fully human, fully alive. Today we gather with hearts broken by sorrow, but also with a sense of gratitude as we thank you for the gift of Jennifer's life, the gift she was to us and to so many others. Loving God, we thank you for the gift of love and the myriad ways in which it exists in this very place. We're grateful for the wonder of human relationships, the ability to know another and be known by them, to be accepted by another and to accept them. And today we particularly thank you for the gift of acceptance that we knew with Jennifer. Her ability to accept us as who we are and love us just that way. Thank you for the opportunity to be loved by her and to love her in this life. And we recognize that it is that love that makes our grief even deeper. God, I pray that you would hold your servants gathered in this place. Hold them in the peace that passes all understanding. Anchor them in your love and give them a sense of security that they can feel what they feel in this sacred space made holy by the presence of your Spirit among us and within each of us. Amen. Jennifer's godmother and aunt have words to share with us today.
Hello, everyone. We are here today to celebrate Jennifer's life. Diana asked me to share some memories of Jen, and I am honored to do so. Our life on this earth is not about the destination, it is about the journey. And Jennifer's journey was most memorable here. When Jen was born, Diana asked me to be her godmother, and I was so truly honored. The first time I held that beautiful baby, I baptized her in the kitchen sink. Diana probably doesn't even know that. Why? Blessed assurance that she was a child of God. I have done that for every one of my godchildren the first time I held them. But Jennifer was special. Diana and I became mothers in our teens. My son Jason is just 1 year older than Jennifer. We were children having children, and we all grew up together. We often took the kids on road trips, and if I was the driver, we usually got lost, but we had such good times. Later, Jason and Jen played house while the adult parents played cards. I think they even watched Rocky II together at the house on Bass Lake. Jennifer was always considered the 11th child in the Lyon family. She grew up in a busy life on the farm, and it was so filled with love. Well, except for when Laura was a baby. She was very jealous of Jen. When Diana or Grandma Mary turned their backs, Laura would bite Jennifer and then sit there with a smile on her face while Jen screamed. They could see the bite marks but could never catch her. Jen was about 4 months old then, Laura a year and a half. They were always like sisters. The uncles teased her endlessly, but that was normal, as Jen thought she was one of the siblings. In fact, the cousins called her Cousin Jen because she was the older cousin and she was the only grandchild for over 15 years. Jennifer did not like to get dirty. Diana had to go through the garbage at the end of the day because if an outfit she was wearing got dirty, she would throw it away. Diana said that Jen was the only kid who could play outside in the sandbox in the dirt and come back in just as clean as when she went out. And in high school, she would convince John to taxi her and her friends to concert at Castle Farms. Their first concert was Def Leppard. She loved Josh Groban and even made scrapbooks of the concerts she attended. I remember I used to call Diana up to find out if Jen had gotten in any trouble yet. Diana would always laugh and say no, and Jen never did. She was very shy as a child, and she didn't even want to go to the counter at McDonald's to ask for ketchup. She overcame her shyness when she began teaching. Jennifer was an amazing teacher. So many learned from her, both students and teacher. My sister Edie, who is the head cook at Westwoods, shared a wonderful memory. Jen held a wedding at school where Q married you. They had kids all dressed up. There was a wedding cake. They had bubbles to blow and wedding favors. And it was the way to show the kids that Q and you almost always go together in words. I looked it up. By the way, there are 1,186 words that begin with QU. This was priceless. Jen met Tom through her friend Patty. The first date was four-wheeling, and Jennifer rode with Tom in his truck, and she had met the love of her life. Jen was very prim and proper for years, and then she brought boys into her life. One time, Ryan and Kyle filled a really large hole in the yard with water, made a mud pit, and then jumped in to have a mud bath. Another time, the boys cut Ryan's old snowboard in half, attached it to their boots, and pulled each other behind the four-wheeler. By the way, this was summertime. Jennifer so enjoyed watching their adventures, and she truly loved being a boy mom. And Aunt Mary Lyon, Grandma to Jennifer, wanted me to share another memory. Grandma Aunt Mary had promised to pray for Jennifer, especially when she was in severe pain. And one day, Jen wondered, why was the pain so severe? Did Grandma forget to pray? Well, the problem was that Grandma Mary got a new iPad and was playing euchre. And another thing, Jennifer made several soft, cuddly blankets for several people, and she passed them out to them, and they cherished them very much. Family has always been the loving center and focus of Jennifer's life. Her earthly journey began and ended surrounded by the love of an amazing family. And now, she has journeyed to heaven and reached the ultimate destination. Jen will forever live on in our hearts and our memories. And this amazing, beautiful person has changed all of our lives by letting us be part of her journey. Thank you.
If I don't look up, I'll be okay. So I apologize now. Dear Jennifer, I wanted you to be able to read this, but time went so fast. You're the closest thing I had to a little sister growing up. With being the youngest of 10, but not the baby, right, Donald? I finally had someone to look up to me. I would bite you and make you cry, and then look surprised when your mom would ask me what was wrong. I remember playing with all of your strawberry shortcake dolls. You had the Barbie dream house and the Barbie Corvette. You got one of the first Cabbage Patch dolls. I sure was jealous. You lived next to Mr. and Mrs. Sarkon. We would walk over there and get treats and hugs. She was a great baker. She was like the grandma I never had. I was so jealous. You were able to celebrate so many Christmases in 1 week with all your different families. I sure was jealous. You worked at Ware's Brothers serving ice cream all day and night while I spent my teen years babysitting and changing diapers. I sure was jealous. You caught the bouquet I tossed at my wedding, and I still remember Tom trying to scoot out of the way when the guys were getting the garter thrown. I remember you limping off the dance floor after the garter was put on your leg. That was quite a moment. It was an honor to plan your bridal shower. We got to judge the toilet paper bride dresses, and of course, Grandma Lion took all the toilet paper home. You were showered with amazing gifts, and I think it was shortly after that that I became allergic to bridal and baby showers, according to Aunt Nita. I sure was jealous. The night of your wedding, a major transformer blew at Frog Pond Village and lost power. You still danced the night away, glowing with love as you gazed constantly at Tom. You didn't care the guests left early or the toilets were backed up. You made the most of it and had a great attitude. I sure was jealous. You were able to talk to your mom every day. I am just excited I remember to call Grandma once a week. It was an honor to help you plan the surprise retirement party for your mother. You were so proud that it was a total success and Diana had no idea. It involved over 100 people and no one spilled the beans. Grandma Lyon should have gone to confession for all the lies she told Diana that afternoon trying to detain her while we were setting up the party room. The bond you and Diana had was so strong, I sure was jealous. Jennifer, the three boys in your life were your whole world. Yes, you yelled at them a time or two, but I sure was jealous of the fun you had as a family. Your teaching career meant you had weekends off while I in the restaurant business did not. But you worked so hard on the weekends and family vacations, reading educational materials to better yourself as a teacher and help so many students have a better life. I sure was jealous. I remember you waking up after your major surgery. To hear you say, I have a catheter, that sucks. It hit me like a ton of bricks. All of a sudden, I was no longer jealous. The last 5 years have been so hard on you and the boys and Diana. How could this happen to someone who didn't smoke, didn't do drugs, who hardly drank and except an occasional Boone's Farm with Patty Manville? I was no longer jealous. I know you are no longer suffering, but you left a big void to fill. We will take turns to call your mother. We promise to help Tom and protect the boys and make Kyle's 12th birthday absolutely amazing. Now I am only jealous that you get to see Grandpa Whitney, Mr. Yannick, and your other grandparents every day up in heaven. And I would like to honor you with the following song, Wind Beneath My Wings.
Thank you, Phyllis and Laura, for your beautiful tributes to Jennifer. The Apostle Paul wrote to the Colossians, "As God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Bear with one another, and if anyone has a complaint against another, forgive each other, just as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. Above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in the one body. And be thankful." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Friends, if you're here, you know magic. You know the magic that was Jennifer Johnson. And you believe in that magic. Not the kind of magic based in illusion, pulling rabbits out of hats or making handkerchiefs into mourning doves. Rather, the kind of magic that she lived every day, a magic based in authenticity. The kind of magic one feels when witnessing love in action, lived out with humility and selflessness. The first story I heard about Jennifer was from her colleague, Sheila Fehrenbach. And as I began reading, I thought, magic. And then I talked to Diana, more magic. And then I read the obituary, more magic. It is the magic that comes not by chance, but by the choices she made. The choice to, in the words of the Apostle Paul, clothe herself each day with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Jennifer lived a life, she learned a life of love from you, from parents and grandparents, aunts and uncles, siblings. And then she shared that love unconditionally with others. With you, Tom, who I heard it said that you had three fights in the 25 years that you knew one another, fights that were probably just more like heated disagreements. And she shared that unconditional love with Tom and her kids and friends and colleagues and community members. Jennifer chose love. That doesn't just happen. You learn it and you choose it every day. And it was that love she lived that gave her that aura of being magical. Hers was the magic that is a teacher who could have gotten by on her laurels, but instead reimagined the curriculum for her students in a way that would get them more excited about learning and using their imaginations to guide their exploration and get invited to a wedding of Q and U. As a colleague, Jennifer found ways to ask important questions that engaged creative thinking that led to productive problem solving, and yet she would never claim any credit for these breakthroughs because her humility in and of itself seemed magical to many. Jennifer's was the magic that is, again, according to Sheila, or how Sheila phrased it when describing their girls' weekends away, Jennifer always came with personalized gifts and activities when the rest of us barely managed to get out the door with toothbrushes. I think that must be them back there. Jennifer was treasured by students, parents, and colleagues, and while she embraced her role as teacher, as we've already heard, and as you know in your hearts, it was not her main priority. Her A number one priority was her family, and somehow she struck what seemingly a magical balance between her work and her boys. Even with a full-time job to which she devoted an overtime amount of creativity and energy, Jennifer prioritized her family, making time for outdoor adventures, even though they were dirty, and they created lifetime memories for you. Your mom shared her love of gardening with you, Kyle. And Kyle, those flowers you planted around your house with her, those will be a reminder to you of the special times you had together. And Ryan, do you think she ever let you win at gin rummy? Oh, sorry, you're Kyle and you're Ryan. I'm really sorry. Kyle, the flowers. Loving memory. And Ryan, do you think she ever let you win at gin rummy? I'm guessing, no, you don't? Then I should just skip this next part. All right, well, you have your treasured memories of gin rummy, okay. But I gotta tell you, as a mom, I'm guessing that she knew when you were having a bad day and you needed a win. But she knew when the day was just fine and it was about being together. I, too, am a mom of a boy, so I kind of get that. Jennifer leaves a magical legacy of a life of loving kindness, well lived. Ryan and Kyle, her spirit lives on in each of you. She loved you so well. And I pray that there will never be a day in your lives when you are not built up by the memories of the love she gave you. I make no bones about it. What has happened is awful. There's no explaining it away or trying to make it better. It just is. And you are surviving a tragedy. And part of the reason you are getting through it is because of her love. And that will be true for the two of you for the rest of your lives. And just know you get to feel what you feel and you get to wonder and you whatever you wonder. There's no right way to do this. I just pray that you too will remember that you are surrounded not just by a family, but by an entire community of people who care about you and are praying for you. Indeed, even as our hearts are breaking and our minds are wondering, and we may even be feeling angry in the midst of what folks these days are calling all the feels, perhaps one of the greatest feelings we have is the feeling of profound gratitude for the opportunity we had to experience the magic that Jennifer brought into the world. Nothing can erase our memories of her bright spirit, boundless energy, and the way she chose each and every day to clothe herself in love. Thanks be to God for the life and magic of Jennifer Johnson. We believe in magic because of her. Thanks be to God.
Fede c'è.
Noi ci affidate.
us faith so we'll be saved. Sogniamo un mondo senza più violenza, un mondo di giustizia e di speranza.
Let us pray. Loving and merciful God, we pray that you will continue to guide us with your grace as we travel through the valley of the shadow of death. May we fear no evil, remembering that you are with us now and always. We remember with gratitude Jennifer's life, wife, mother, sister, aunt, cousin, niece, teacher, leader, neighbor, friend. So many ways to think of someone so precious and dear. We are grateful for everything in her life that was good and honorable, for what was magical about her, for all the love she shared. We pray that you would help us to live with that kind of grace, that kind of selfless giving, that spirited living that shows your love. We are so grateful that for Jennifer, all sickness and sorrow are ended, and death itself has passed, and she has been reabsorbed into you, into perfect light and life and love. And we pray that in these coming days, you would enable us to weep and to laugh, to rebuild even as we remember, and to create lives of loving kindness. Thank you for supporting us during all the days of our lives, just as you did for Jennifer. Encourage us to live fully. Encourage us to live peacefully and with humility. Thank you for Jennifer's family gathered here today. Thank you for all the love they showed her, and hold them, Lord, hold them in your love and mercy and compassion as they find their way forward. May Ryan and Kyle never know a moment in their lives when they are not keenly aware of your presence with them. So cognizant of the foundation of love with which their mother and their father raised them. Indeed, as we move forward, O God, we pray for grace just for the day. Enough to get through. And the courage to face tomorrow. And to live it in the spirited, loving ways in which Jennifer lived. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus our Christ, in whom we have new life and the life everlasting, the one who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Loving and merciful God, accept into your eternal embrace and mercy your loving servant, Jennifer Johnson, a daughter of your own flock, a child of your own redeeming. We bring to you our prayers of gratitude that her suffering is over and pray that her spirit would live. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and be gracious to you. Go now in peace. Amen.
Thank you very much. I would also like to thank each and every one of you joining us here in person as well as on.